Call. Make them into a paper airplane, fly them, it doesn't matter. Call.
Okay. I didn't know if we
But the Thursday's too soon. I'm just trying to.
I kind of think it is. That's just 2 days.
You want to come back next Monday? Tuesday?
Well, we can do that. Next week?
Well, we're just getting the survey together. So.
Yeah, as long as you got
one.
Like,
yes. Yes.
It's okay. Monday works for me.
Monday. Morning's work? Morning's work? You'll be gone.
Yeah, I'm gone.
We still want your questions. Adrian, would Monday morning at 9 work?
We'd hate to hunt you down. I have to hunt you down.
25th Monday morning at 9? Okay. Well, this committee will come back together. Yes. Monday morning at 9?
I'm supposed to be out of town Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. Is that right, Lisa?
Yes, sir.
Well,
we need him here.
Yeah.
Chris, he's got a list of our situation, what we're concerned about anyway right now. We don't need to meet again, you know. It's either go or no go. That's where we're coming from.
We're getting to that.
It's taking you a while. I mean, we're here too. You're talking among yourselves. What about us? We're the ones that this meeting's about, I thought. Am I wrong or left or right?
Well, I think we're trying to get to exactly what's going on.
Well, we got the list right there. The man will tell you what's going on.
All right, let's see.
Okay. Like I said a moment ago, it's a liability and a responsibility of each bus driver. We feel like that we're underpaid for those obligations for our professionalism. Even though we can't call ourselves professional drivers, we're like a doctor. A doctor can make straight D's, and a doctor can make straight A's, but they get the same diploma. And our problem is having problems with discipline on the school buses and getting help from some of the principals. Our problem on the school bus is doing a lot of double backing over half the route or the full route just to take a child home. Our problem just rests in communication. And it's a hassle out there with those kids and their discipline problem. And we need to do something, as we talked before, and start teaching these kids different programs at school, how to act and conduct themselves on a school bus, get the backing from the board and from the principal. I'm not saying you have it. I'm just saying we need stronger backing. We need to be treated as bus drivers and not just somebody picked up off the street, and have respect. None of the bus drivers feel like that anybody respects them through the system. Some of these people are, since I was getting this petition up, I had the opportunity to talk to a new number of them. I'm retired, and I'm driving the bus because I enjoy it. And these people that's under my age, that's doing this for a living, can't make a living at 57, even though I know it went to 60. You couldn't live under $60. You can't live under $70. And we're just asking for a fair price so that they can live and enjoy life as well as anybody else. I think, and they think, that all the tax money and all the efforts ought to be left in our county, support our county, and manage this county before that everybody can cooperate together in unity. And I understand the issues that Chris has brought forward. I don't disagree with the survey, but the survey, in a lot of ways, Brother Dunn said, that has, everybody knows the situation. We beat around the bush, that bush is going to jump up and beat all of us to death.
So, well, we are under a time constraint, and we truly are. We truly are. So we want to get down to the bare facts of it, we can. And it seems like we're heading that way. Comes down to money. Money and respectability. Is that two good words? Now, I've got some ideas and some suggestions on some things that, not everything that you just mentioned, but I've got some ideas that I'm going to present to this committee. Now, as far as the subway goes, we've got over 112 licensed drivers. And how many bus drivers are in attendance tonight? And how many can you speak for? For us to be as fair as we possibly can to the system, the taxpayers, and the bus drivers, and first and foremost the students, we've got to be well informed before we make any decisions. It's not that we don't believe you. No, I agree with you. I agree. Ever since I've been sitting on, was elected to this position, one of my first goals were is to help the bus drivers. It's always been that way. But you just don't snap your fingers and make things happen. Especially in government. Now, I don't mean to sound smart or anything, but we're going to get to the end of it. So, working conditions, respectability, getting support from administration, getting help with disciplinary measures. We've discussed these things. And we've discussed them, but it becomes problematic. It does. Because this system is under obligations for, I always say, in attendance. We've got to have you guys. We've got to have the students there. But when there's disciplinary issues, how do you best handle
it? I think a lot of times, if you go back to your handbook, in a lot of it, and go back to the foundation, you have drivers out there that I train. Almost a year ago or less, are making more money and top pay than some of these drivers have been driving for 5 or 6 years. And that's not right. What is a professional driver? How long do you work to be a professional driver? Or classified and experienced driver, let me put it that way. And I think after you had the first year of experience driving a school bus, you're experienced that second year. But a truck driver is experienced by insurance and other clauses, 2 years experience.
Right.
And it's not right to bring in a teacher, coach, and et cetera, regardless of who they are or how many teaching years they got behind them. They ought to start out on the bottom scale just like anybody else does and work their way up, even though they have the credentials and their experience in teaching. That is a whole different animal than driving a school bus.
Okay. Committee, let's address this issue. Yes.
The shortage that we have of bus drivers, a lot of it has to do with people moving in here in Hawkins County have driven for 35, 40 years.
Hang on. We're fixing to address that. If I might. Okay.
In regard to the attendance of the bus drivers tonight, I was notified 2 days ago about the meeting, and you know, this is the only time we can really do anything, and other people's got jobs. I mean, you can't put down the bus drivers because they're not all 90 or whatever driving an active school bus because, you know, 90 people's not here.
But you want to base our decision on the minority.
Well, he's got the number right there on the paper of the people. They can't be here. I mean, they've got jobs too. They've got to have another job to make a living.
We understand that.
It don't sound like it.
It don't sound like you're being very understanding.
I'm being super understanding.
Okay. To answer your question, this committee, the way it's set up now, years of experience If you've driven a bus outside of Hawkins County, you're a certified bus driver, and you come into Hawkins County, you start at 0 years of experience. That's the way it is now in Hawkins County. I think, being a driver myself, that your experience as a bus driver needs to follow you where you go. Okay. I mean, is that the I would like to make that a recommendation to pass on to the full board.
Okay, let me make sure I understand what you're saying. That, regardless of what years of experience they have when they come here to Hawkins County, they start with 0 years of.
That is correct. Know. That's the way it starts. That's where it is now.
Where it is,
yeah,
right.
That's what I'm saying.
If they come from a different district, now if they quit Hawkins County and come back, then they're given credit for what time they drove from Hawkins County.
Yeah,
but you know, if you're a bus driver, you're a bus driver.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Yeah, I'm trying to get to all of these points.
I didn't know that either.
Does that answer your question, ma'am?
Yes. Thank
you. Okay. I'm trying to get to all of this. Everybody, just please be patient. There's a lot at stake here. It's very important.
It is.
So that's, Ms. Jennifer, could you read that back, please? The recommendation for this committee to send to the full board. It would be our recommendation that verifiable driving experience, bus driving experience, be counted at day of hire. Would that be correct, Aiden?
Sounds right. Are you talking about inside the state of Tennessee or this?
Oh, I think that's better.
Wherever you drive.
No, we're
Indiana,
Michigan,
or wherever, it should be counted.
Yeah.
If you're a certified bus driver.
Like that gentleman says, the teacher comes in, they come in with that experience from wherever, but they're bringing it, they're being compensated for those years of experience. So there's no difference there.
Here's the next question. I'm just going to throw them at you. The next question before this committee is, let's say I'm a teacher, and I've been teaching for 20 years. Teacher, not a bus driver, but I'm a teacher. And I run out, and I get a CDL and a bus driver endorsement. And I come to Mr. Bunch, make application, say I want to drive a bus. He hires me. You know what pay scale I start out at?
You should start out at zero because you're not a bus driver.
Start out at the pay scale of 20 years.
But you was a teacher.
That's the way it is.
I'm a banker, but I can't drive a bus.
But if you go get your CD, if you were a teacher.
Just if I get a license, don't mean I can drive a bus.
Well,
I can read a book.
Well, if you get the license now, you can drive the bus, because you got to drive the bus before you get the
there
license.
There it is.
Okay, I'm just presenting the information.
No, that's wrong.
Okay, I'm just presenting the information. That is a concern of the bus drivers, am I correct?
True.
I think it's likely that you know, in a employee.
Okay, not just teachers.
Folks, I'm new at this, but I'm learning a whole lot. But I think it would be
any employee, not just teachers. I don't want to use the word teacher. Any employee.
No.
Any employee.
But we will check that out to make sure.
Is that in the policy?
There's no policy.
I didn't see that.
Couldn't find the policy of it.
So how is it instituted if there's no policy on it?
That's why it's a recommendation to the full board.
May I say something, Chris?
Please stand up, please.
So we can't hardly hear you.
All right. Before I retire, I was a janitor.
Can you come up to the front so he gets you on the mic?
I got hung up in the
chair. Driving the bus.
That was rough. I was going to fall down back there. Now, what?
Come on, just kidding. Come right here. We try to get it on.
Oh, okay. All right. Until year before last, I was a custodian of it, volunteer. All right. I hired in the county down here in 08 to drive schools. So what he's saying here is this. Whenever I had 6 years in Harvey, that went to work the custodian, and I hired him the same day as one other one, and I got, I don't know. 75 cents more on an hour because of what he said. So it don't matter whether you're a teacher and go to a bus driver, or whether you're a bus driver and go to be a teacher, your seniority, the way they've got set up over there, your seniority takes you up a higher scale. So
you got your year's experience for working at Polly's here as a bus driver?
It carried from the bus driver to being a custodian at the volunteer.
So it goes both ways.
It goes both ways. So what you're saying is, you know, it needs, the whole system needs to be reworked.
I'm just concerned as to how that's documented and how it's in, you know, what is the reference to give you guidance on that? I mean, you got to have, there's somewhere, somebody, unless somebody come up with a bright idea somewhere, that ought to be on a policy somewhere.
Or at least a procedure.
Well, you can't have a procedure without a policy. You got to have a policy before you have a procedure.
Well, okay.
That's a state law.
Okay, you know,
moving forward.
Wait a minute. Well, I don't know when that started or how it was. I know when Mr. Bunch and I were talking, he relayed to me he didn't get his years' experience toward being a supervisor, although he'd been a supervisor for 13, 14 years.
Wow.
Before coming here and starting at zero. So I went back and I asked, you know, about that, but I didn't go back to see when that started. So I can ask that.
I mean, who are you gonna ask?
Let's just move forward and fix it.
We're going to have to develop a policy for this.
That's why it needs to go to the full board.
This
needs to go to the full board. Okay, so level of experience, we're addressing that issue, right? Give me another.
Well, like I said, them getting more money just starting out, and...
Here, I got one for you.
All right.
It was shared with me on my way in here. Bus drivers depend on this job to make a living, correct? You don't do it to make extra money. Some of you do. Some of you don't. Some of you, this is your livelihood. You're a full-time driver or retired substitute driver / can't be full-time because... So the next thing that I would like to make this committee aware of, and you guys help me explain this. Let's say we've got someone that is a state employee, has retired from the state, worked for the city, worked for the school system in some form or fashion, but retired from the state. And the state says you can't hold a full-time job. You can't hold a full-time job, but yet you can come and be a part-time bus driver. But you're driving a bus full-time. But by that stipulation, you can't be
classified
full-time. Therefore, you're on the substitute bus driver pay scale. Am I correct?
You're correct.
So in order to make this more enticing to come and drive for Hawkins County, can we change that? So it would. Here's another recommendation. Ladies and gentlemen, like I said earlier, we can't make any decisions here tonight. All we can do is make recommendations to send to the full board. Okay? So here's another recommendation that we recommend sending to the full board, that barring any unknown state law or regulation, that any person that wants to drive for Hawkins County that has already retired but is going to drive full-time and make that commitment that can't be full-time on paper, receive the same benefits of pay based on years of experience.
So in essence, what you're saying is it, even though there is a, there could potentially be a restriction by a former employee or whatever the case, employer or whatever the case may be, as far as making, because I know in a lot, I know for like for me on combat disability, you know, once you get to a certain point, you can't work. You can't make any more money.
You can't, and like I said, barring
under no circumstances,
barring any unforeseen state law or regulation that will need to be looked into prior to the board meeting. Yes.
It may be within the retirement system itself.
And it could be.
And that I believe that's where we have to look, because once a teacher retires, and we're talking about, we can come back on a contract of 120 days, but if we work over that contract, then it will pass on time.
But does it limit the amount of money you're reimbursed?
I'm not.
See, that's the whole scope of this thing is the money. If I'm a retired, if I retired from Rogersville City as a city employee, and I have a CDL license, and I come to Hawkins County School, say I'm going to drive a bus, and Rogersville City Retirement says I can only work 120 days, but I've got 20 years experience driving a bus, I want to come in on that 20-year pay scale. I'll just work 120 days, but I'm a bus driver, and I want you, and Hawkins County Schools needs me, so I'm going to make it as attractive as I can. Am I on the right track? Okay, so that would be a recommendation, barring any unforeseen state law or regulation or retirement limitations, let that come back to the full board. And that's, of course, that's just a recommendation. You can say, oh, you're nuts.
No. Sir?
Yes.
In your recommendation, could you put in there, or you might discuss this, would that be retroactive, or would that start from this point
no,
on?
No, we couldn't. No, I wouldn't.
I mean, as far as the driver, not the money or anything, I'm saying the driver. If they've got that 20 years, but they've only been five at the bus shop, in other words, can it be retroactive to the point that their years be counted?
Yeah, I would say at this stage in the game, let's get it to the full board to make it. I don't know, that's a good question.
Yeah, can we call it? If I understand what she's asking, then you could potentially go forward with it. We can't go backwards, but we could go forward. We could go, let me just give you a scenario. Let's say, for instance, that on this scale that we've got proposed for this year's budget, a bus driver comes in, and they may have come in at zero, but they had this other experience that we're talking about. We make a policy for that, and let's say they came in at zero, and they've been driving for 2 years, but we find out they already had 9 years worth of experience before that. Then the next year, we could bump them up to that level.
Yes, that's
not making it retroactive. That's
no, that's doing it forward. Yes. That way we could budget for it. That's the thing. Because we can't budget for retroactivity.
Right.
But we could say, okay, we're going to let those bus drivers that came in at zero and they had 9 years worth of experience, the next budget year, as we turn around, we're going to bump them up
to
that pay level.
That was the phrase I was using.
Yeah, that's
go back and pick up those years.
We could recommend that.
That would have to be verifiable.
Yeah, we would have to verify. Yeah. We would have to have verifiable evidence, you know, from former school systems or whatever, former employees that have bus services or whatever that you in fact had that experience, and then we could put that in so we would know whoever our super transportation supervisor is would have record of that, and then he would know the next year, so we could budget for it, that X number of drivers are going to move up several notches on the. And once we get everybody there, then there won't be no question for it after we get a policy in place.
Right.
It'll work then.
So, what's the recommendation? Let's clarify that.
Okay. Just find out certain way.
We'll see. Go ahead.
A retired person who drives full time, but they're not full time on paper.
Right.
Get paid for the years of experience.
Barring any limitations. But we need to add in there.
Well, go ahead and finish that. Go ahead and finish this first.
Yeah,
let's finish this before we get. Is that the end of it, Jennifer?
Yeah, except okay. For barring state
any,
laws.
Any complications that we run into as we develop.
Chris, can y'all speak up a little bit? You know, the meeting's kind of concerning us. Can you share a little bit with us? Maybe a little louder.
Louder, yeah, I can get loud.
You want to you come in good.
Yeah, I'm a Baptist preacher. I can get real loud.
You do.
I'm in a pack, but it's been a long time.
Thank you.
Maybe you can move up just a little. I'm in the pack and I hear you fine.
Well, I retract my statement here. Sorry.
Okay, we've got that part done. But we're going to have to figure out, and this is just, I don't know that. This is going to have to be clarified before we present it to the full board anyway.
Yeah.
So what my perception is that at whatever point that we come to an agreement on the bus driver scale, that if any drivers that are already in the system or whatever that have bus driving experience, we will look at putting an option in there that once we determine their qualification for those years of bus driving bus in the next year, we will take them to that experience level.
Moving forward, so we will have the opportunity to budget for them.
Right, because we can't do anything backwards. Sorry, I like retroactivity too, I really do. But I don't see anything wrong with trying to get those drivers with experience up to the level of pay that we have on our scale with verification.
Okay. How we doing?
Keep
going and speak up.
You're on the roll. I got one more thing to add to that. Is my mic on?
Just stay up here this time.
All right, I'll try to speak a little bit louder. I'm a Sunday school teacher, brother.
All right, amen, brother. I'm on your side.
All right. I know we have one bus driver that is retired, just like it's been spoken by here, that's having to drive as a part-time driver. Is he not having to drive on the pay scale of zero?
Correct.
Then should it not be that you, if he...
That's what we just changed. Our recommendation is to change that.
I thought we would, for like this lady that come in.
That's everybody. Hey, we're not going to dissimulate anybody. We're going to... We don't care what you look like or how much money you got. We're going to give it to everybody.
Okay, the next issue, disciplinary measures. Right?
Let me say something, Chris. I've been on the school board almost 4 years. And I look back on this crowd, and I don't see any school bus drivers that I know of have complained to me on the telephone about any issues. However, I have had several calls about not only the disciplinary issues on the bus, the inactivity of the principals to do anything about it, the fact that there's kids being left at school And as far as I'm concerned, in other words, they're not getting out and catching the bus on time, and our drivers are leaving, going on their routes, and having to turn around and go back to the school and pick those kids up. Now, wait, whoa, I'm not done. I got to go. So this is the thing. Those are the three issues that I have been addressed personally by school bus drivers anonymously and some that I know. Okay? Now, and I agree that we need to somehow to come up with some type of a systematic way of getting our students informed of what we expect of them and how they're to act on a school bus. And we all know kids are kids, and things happen that cause spontaneous reactions from them. And that's one of the things we have to deal with. The next thing is the fact that as these drivers are going on their routes, and I've ridden some routes. I've ridden some school bus routes. And with some issues that drivers have, they call me and said, "Hey, look, I got an issue that I need to deal with, and I don't know how to do it." I said, "Well, what time do you leave your house and where do you live? And I'll come ride the bus with you and we'll take care of it," which we did. But anyway, the thing that really gets me, number one, is, and I know we've got to figure out how to get these kids educated on how to act on a school bus. We've got to start real young.
Well,
and then the thing about it is, our principals have got to get proactive in this, and they've got to make sure that whoever is responsible for those kids, no matter come if they've got to herd them out the door, they've got to get them to catch that school bus when it leaves there. And we're going to have to figure out how we're not going to turn our buses around and go get them.
So that's the question I wanted to ask. Why would they miss the bus, number one? And why does a bus driver have to go back and get a kid?
To take them home.
But why is that responsibility?
That's the way it's been. And that's the way it's been dictated in the past by, as I understand it, from the administration of the school system.
Well, I will say this. I will say that for the first 2 weeks of school, there's not a bus driver in here that doesn't know that these kids don't know which way they're going most of them.
Yeah, I think that's true.
Okay. And I ask these bus drivers at our startup meetings to be patient for a couple of weeks. Mm-hmm. A couple of weeks, you know, we're going to have kids that don't know where they're supposed to be, and that's reasonable.
Right.
But after 2 weeks, mm-hmm. I hear it a lot because I've been having to drive a lot. And I hear a lot about coming back to the kids and this, that, and the other. And some drivers voluntarily, they say, "I'll be back to get them." Well, they don't say a whole lot, but they go back and get them for one time. Now, I can understand going back maybe once. I'm not going to say that. I do that myself. But when I'm already halfway through my route, somebody calls me and tells me to come back and get the kid, you're going to have to call mom and come get
yeah,
you.
Absolutely.
That's my point.
Absolutely.
I'm just saying that if you've already started your route and you're that far into it, you shouldn't be coming back.
Oh, yeah.
You just pick up and tell me.
Okay. And here's, actually, I've given this thought too. We need to educate our students to the proper bus conduct and safety on a bus, and that needs to start in the kindergarten level.
Amen.
Now, I propose, with the agreement of this committee, is to get with the principals to develop programs within the schools to incorporate training. However, and there's been some good suggestions already made to me of the principals that I've talked to, to educate our children, because the bus is an extension of the classroom. It's in policy. It's in the handbook. It's an extension of the classroom. Now, the ideas that I've heard is it's making phone calls, meeting with parents, what have you. But there's been some good ideas. And the principals that I've talked to so far have been receptive in trying to develop programs within their schools. Because it's problematic for the principals also to get the disciplinary things. from the bus drivers. It's problematic. Yes.
So we can have all the education and everything that we can have for the students, but if we're not going to have somebody back us up administrative-wise, it does absolutely no good.
I appreciate the statement you made, and you're bringing it out. But until we start this communication process, now we're hearing what you're saying, and we're trying to come up with some ideas to make things better, because I want to get a transportation department that is the envy of all the surrounding schools. And to get that, you have to have communication. You're part of this team. That's what we're here tonight.
I have a question as well.
Yes.
In the student handbook, does it address any of those issues about transportation?
You know, I need to
because that goes directly to the parents, correct?
Correct.
So if there's a clause in there that says if your child misses the bus for
that's not what I'm getting to.
But then the parent is already aware of the fact if your child just lollygagging around, miss the school bus, you might come get it.
Well, here, for instance, mostly younger kids, right?
No.
I said more teenagers.
Bigger kids.
Those are going to be the issue. The ones that know better.
But if we say we take, you know, the first couple of days of school, it's hectic anyway. And I'm not screaming. I'm talking loud. So, but if we can implement some of these programs to educate these kids at some form of fashion on all levels, what else can we do? If they miss the bus and we've tried to instruct them on it, that's like teaching them 2 + 2 = 4, and they get the answer wrong. That's, you know, what else can we do? And at least we're making the attempts here to rectify the problem. So that would be my recommendation, is to come back next week with this committee or whoever wants to show up, with any principals that want to show up, and brainstorm a little bit, and then send that on to the full commission.
And I'd like to make a recommendation of you in the handbook, because you're educating the parent with that.
I agree with that. And we need to write that.
Informed.
Hang on one second. Come to the front, please.
Kind of amplify what you're saying, we have no way of knowing whether or not any of our students or their parents ever read that handbook.
That's not our problem.
But the problem you'll run into is the argument of the safety of those children.
Well, I think
Ms. Charles is saying, let's put it in the handbook, right, but let's do the training also.
Thing about it, this is the point I was getting to. I think we gotta figure out a way when school starts have an orientation of our handbooks at every level.
Well, you know, next week when we meet with the principals, we can do that, can't we? It can be not a committee but a workshop.
Concerning that issue, if I'm not mistaken, when my grandchildren brought those policy books home, I had to sign it and send it back that I could read it.
Well, yeah, yeah. But everybody don't do
that.
But everybody don't do that.
Okay, all right. We got somebody to vote.
On your education program that you want to start up for kids' behavior on a bus, also, this is the first time I've ever worked anywhere, and I've driven for over 35 years, where we do not have evacuation drills. These kids do not know how to evacuate a bus.
You know?
We did it 3 times a year.
Thank you for that. And that's what we've got to get to. But I want to implement this on the school level.
Correct.
I want to implement that. I had 5 years ago a vision of making a video, letting the kids have fun with it, saying this is how not to act on a bus, and this is how you're supposed to act. And you know, we're going to brainstorm this thing and be creative. So it would be my recommendation that we come back next week with the principals, say Wednesday or Thursday, and put something down on paper.
I can't come on Wednesday.
Okay, well, Thursday. Thursday at some point. It's not an official meeting. It's just a workshop.
Chris, can I ask a question? They need to stand. How long should you wait on a child? Time-wise, you know, the kid just being slow about coming out. And you're on a schedule. You know about what time. After a while, you know you got your time set up. But how long? Say he's going to pick one up at 6:30, and he wasn't there. How long would I wait from 6:30 on?
That's a tough question. That's a professional estimate.
Well, I mean,
I've been driving the school bus. We have this is I can't say where it come from, but we have a 5 minute window. That kid ought to know to be there within that 5 minutes of when that bus is regularly. There's not a bus driver in here that's probably not off 30 seconds to 1 minute. If you wait a minute on this child coming out of the house, and you go down to Jackie's house and wait on her grandkid for a minute, minute and a half, you are getting behind schedule of a morning to be able to get that kid to school or to make connection with another bus or to get their breakfast or whatever they do when they get to school. But making connections, meeting these buses on transfers, our minutes count. I mean, everybody in here knows it takes you an average of a good 35 and 40 mile an hour where it's accepted to meet your destinations of a morning.
Bill, to answer your question, to the best of my ability, the thought went through my head. I'm watching a movie. There's a city bus going down a city street. There's a school bus. There's a bus stop sign by it. Nobody's standing at it. Bus slows down, doesn't see anybody, and keeps going, and then you see this guy running, chasing the bus down. I can't answer that, Bill, and I'm not trying to be smart or anything.
Well, I'll say this. Regular ed school bus drivers, we should not be waiting on anybody.
Amen.
Okay? Be at the stop. If you want to ride the boat, you got to get beside the dock, okay? If you're going to go, get down there. Now, I'm not saying that there's not a child wait once in a while and you see it coming, you stop and wait on that. I've been a bus driver for 40 years, and I don't care to wait on them if I see them coming one time. And I'm going to tell them, listen, this boat goes by here at the same time.
Well, I think that's some of the things that we can take care of in this meeting with the principals and the education of the students. We can develop these kind of things. But thank you for asking that question. That's a good question.
Yeah.
That's a good question.
Sped drivers are a little bit different. You know, they have a lot of different things they have to deal with. Yeah. And I'll say this right up front. We got some of the best sped drivers there is in the state of Tennessee. They care about what they do.
True.
And they go out of their way. They go way out of their way to try to accommodate these children, and I understand that. Sometimes I think, though, they sometimes get themselves in trouble by being. If you do something one time, sometimes you get in trouble for it. We've discussed that a few times. So that happens.
Okay. The next concern is, Adrian, can you give us some air?
It's frozen.
Okay.
You have to blow, Adrian.
This was a concern that was presented to me. We have bus drivers working as secretaries and assistants inside the school. Correct?
Yes.
And if there is a trip from that school during the day, some of these assistants or janitors are taking that bus on that field trip, let's call it. But yet they've got, see if I can explain this, you got driver pay and then you've got employee pay. If they're a driver in the mornings and afternoons, that's driver pay. If they're driving during the day while they're supposed to be at their employee job at that school, they're getting employee pay. Am I correct? That is correct. The concern is these drivers slash employees could be, well, they are, they're taking these bus routes away from bus drivers only that have no other way to supplement in between morning and night. Am I correct? Am I correct?
That's right.
Okay. Now,
is that assigned or how does that happen?
I don't know. I'm just stating what was stated to me.
Well, what happens on a lot of the field trips is that the schools, if they've got somebody working inside the school, they know that person's on payroll, so they're going to save that $10 an hour on that trip. They're going to use that person. And the schools do all that. We don't have anything to do with assigning them. When we get a field trip sent in, if they've not already got the driver in place, then we call drivers and ask them when they want to take the trip, and that's how we do the trip.
Let me give you an example. I'm a full-time driver. I drive up morning and evening. After school, at 4:30, I'll go to a certain high school, pick up football players, me and Hutch. Okay? Right. 54. Me and him have been doing that for a couple of years. Take the football team. Okay? Now, a certain person gets their driver's license. Just started. Me or him one's going to be bumped because he took that position. And that's our bread and butter. That is a scenario right there. Now then, me or Hutch is not going to be able to go on them football trips to make our extra income because this one got his license just especially for that.
Because that's done at the school level.
And you see where the bus drivers is getting kicked off because the freeloaders.
One word. All right. Well, we have that number that I told out about the number of drivers a while ago. We've got 90 school bus drivers, but we've got another 15 people that drive school buses that
can pick and choose.
They can pick what trip they want because they can go anytime they want to go because they don't drive a school bus. So if they've got a trip leaving at 2:00, they can leave at 2:00 because school bus driver can't do it. But now, will they substitute the route? No, they will not substitute. That's where I have an issue with anybody that drives a school bus. If you're going to be able to drive it on a trip, and I've got a driver that's got a sickness, or I've got a driver that's in the hospital, and you can't help me with that, I've always had a little bit of an issue with that. So I
think our obligation are to our full-time drivers that are dependent on
us. Yes, I
agree. The offer be made to them first, then if there's not a full-time driver available, then it falls back to the school employee bus driver.
Right. That could be handled in the policy we developed.
That would be a recommendation.
Yeah, that we can handle that in the policy.
Good?
That works.
Because you're going to always, once in a while, have a trip that leaves at 2, and we cannot run them.
Correct.
And that's true.
That has to go back.
Okay.
Do you think that may be the reason it was working that way, because you had a regular route? I mean, I'm just asking a question. No, trying to wrap my head around it.
What?
Could it be? Oh, wait.
Give you an example. This person that I was talking about is a teacher or a coach, drive full-time of morning, full-time of evening, and then taking hours. That's where we're at. Does that
answer it?
Yes,
it does. It looks to me like if he's teaching during the day, then it's not got an issue with his hours of service. You have to be careful about hours of service.
Yeah, there's a, ladies and gentlemen, now there's a lot, we're talking in broad terms here. Very, very broad terms. Now, it's going to take some very smart people to sit down and research a lot of state laws. You don't see the point? But I just want you to understand, It's very difficult. You know, what we're saying here tonight, we're trying to make good suggestions. But I'm not guaranteeing any of this can work. Some of it can, some of it possibly can't. I'm saying it won't work, but this is all contingent upon what the state says, what the regulations are. Am I correct, Mr. Buck? Yeah. So I just wanted to take a moment and explain that. So we've addressed, in my opinion, the majority of the issues. Are we done?
What about a pay raise?
I knew that was going to be you. Well, that's what we're going to, Bill. That's the tough
one. Our pay tell me to be a Cherokee at 8:15. Okay, I'm there at 8:15. We don't leave out 8:45. That teacher said, we are time for 8:45. That's not my fault, she threw her out. You know what I mean? Yeah, we got a few of them to do that.
If they had you show up that time, you got that time back. They got the off that, they can call.
This chair.
Let's all come back to come out every day.
They cop all the attitude they want. If they take you to be there at 8:15, you're there, they need to pay for that.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Here we go.
Lock and load.
All right. We've got a $3 pay increase already scheduled for this year. Okay? So that brings us to $60 for a starting driver. Okay? What if we bump the pay again, and then we said every 60 school days we will put a dollar amount at that end of that 60 school days if you have met a certain list of things that have to be done in order to get that. And that, I'm not talking about $2 either, okay? I'm talking about something that will get you to where you want to be. And we do that every 60 school days, three times a year, okay? So what we're talking about with that. Bonus type deal, and I'm not going to say bonus. I don't know what it would be called, but
incentive, maybe incentive.
An incentive, we'll call it an incentive. We're talking about attendance. If you miss a day, you're out. If you attend all your meetings that we hold, startup meetings, safety meetings, state meetings. We attend all of those. That's going to be included as a part of the safety deal. There may be 10 things on this agenda, like I'm going to call it an agenda, but it's actually a list of things that we need to do. If we do that, we're going to get this bonus. And it's not a $2 bonus. We're trying to get this to where it's going to make a difference, okay? And if we can do that, that's going to get you really close to what you're asking for. The only difference is you have to be here, and we have to be conscious of, and that's not to say you people aren't. I make another statement again. We got a really good group of bus drivers in this county, and dedicated people. And
I know that this committee wants to try to help you achieve what you're looking for. And I believe we can do it. And we just need, we'll have to come up with the numbers to go in these blanks that I'm leaving, okay? But once we've done that, then they'll bring it back to you and let you look at it. But I really think that it'll be a win-win for everybody. It'll get you what you want. And if you're here and you're doing what you're supposed to do out there on the road and we have no issues, then it's a win-win for everybody. Yes, sir.
Let me ask you a question, Mr. Bush. What about a new employee, been here 1 year, how long do they have to wait before they can get the medical insurance?
1 year.
1 year.
1 year. 1 year. And what the school system does right now and going to continue to do is they pay, if you come into the school system as a new employee and you want insurance, well, we can't do insurance right for a year. We're gonna give you a $350 stipend. You go get insurance and we'll pay up to $350 of that insurance cost.
Per month.
Per month, with a receipt that you've got insurance, we'll pay $350 of that insurance cost.
Good.
That's new employees. If you've been here a year, you're eligible for the school district insurance.
You can get the benefit. Under the state plan that we work under,
same thing a teacher's job.
Under the state plan that we have, that's a requirement of the insurance carrier. Am I correct, Ms. Bailey? That's a requirement from there because you get into number of hours worked. It's complicated. It truly is.
I just thought that'd be incentives for a new employee.
Well, the best that we've been down this road many times, and the best that we've been able to do is to come up with that $350 per month for the first year to pay toward an individual getting a personal insurance.
I didn't know that. There's
Yeah, that's been in place since 2016.
It's after 30 days of employment.
So yeah, right. Yeah, that's after 30 days of employment.
After the first
30 days, you go get your insurance, bring in your premium receipts, and the county will reimburse you up to, not to exceed, $350 per month for the first year.
Is that guaranteed and in writing?
Yes, absolutely.
It's on there. So the reason I asked that is I heard an individual say that they did that and they got paid the first $350, and then for whatever reason, and I'm speaking just vaguely because I don't know the whole circumstances, that they didn't quit and they were left holding the bag paying for the insurance.
No, they didn't take the receipt in if they didn't.
Right. You have to do it.
I'm speaking vaguely. I don't know.
Yeah. There would be a procedure involved with this, an accounting procedure, so we could track everything. And they would have to be, I'm assuming there would have to be a document.
It's defined here on the pay scale, the last paragraph, after 30 days of employment, Hawkins County School Board of Education will reimburse bus drivers up to $350 per month toward the purchase of private health insurance during their first year of employment until they are eligible for system health insurance. Bus drivers will be required to provide proof of payment for private health insurance before receiving monthly reimbursement. Then that was board approved May the 3rd, 2016.
I apologize. I should have read that.
Well, it's down there on the pay scale.
Come to the front, please.
I was hired 2 years ago, and they paid mine. I was retired, but they paid my Blue Cross and Blue Shield right on time.
So it works.
Yeah.
Good deal.
Yeah, it works.
It works.
Good deal.
Okay.
All right. I've got a quick question. So with the incentive thing, going back to that real quick, you're saying if you're here every day for that 60 days, What if you get the flu or you have a heart attack, or does that automatically knock you out of it?
And for that 60 days, the next 60 days you'd be ill.
You may be dead.
Yeah, death benefits come in.
Chris, you have
something? Yeah, with the incentive, do y'all have a ballpark about what kind of figure you're talking about?
We've not come up with a number yet.
Would it be close to 1,200? Because if we're asking for $20 extra, that'd be 36 in a year, 3,600. If you cut it into three separates, that's 1,200 for the incentive, right? Is what it should be.
Well, you're not asking for 20.
Well, as far as I recall, that's what the petition was going around
for.
Well, that's an extra 20 for a new bus driver coming on, right?
No.
No.
Actually, it was...
Like $18.
You're asking for 75.
Okay.
Zero. At 0 years of experience. Tentatively, this board approved the pay scale...
At $60 at year zero, starting pay.
Now that incentive, that's just like a bonus. Like just
it would be just like a bonus.
Say $100 or something like that. But yes. Like she said, if you was to get a flu, you're totally knocked out in the next 60 days.
So the next 60 days.
But what does that solve for her? Her pay scale stays.
Her pay scale is going to be whatever it is on the pay scale.
Minus the bonus.
Minus the bonus.
But now, we're talking about increasing the pay scale. Again.
Okay, but you're increasing the pay scale, but it cuts out if you're given just
not the pay scale.
So you're getting a pay scale increase plus an incentive on top of that.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. That's to get you where you're going to be.
Let's say, let's put it out there. We're at 60. We're at 60. We go to 65 with the incentive bonuses. Let's call it incentive bonuses. And there's criteria that you have to adhere to be eligible for the bonus. And let's say that bonus is every 60 days you're eligible for $200. That's $600 a year. On top of the $65 per day. That don't get touched. Yes.
I understand the incentive part and I do agree with it in a lot of ways. But when you come down to, I understand we have some bus drivers that take a lot of sick days. But if you take into account like some of our bus drivers who have medical condition where out of the blue, they're not ones that normally miss. That would take something away from them. And is there a way to do the incentive that doesn't account for that part?
You can't do an incentive that, say, say you've got a full-blown medical excuse.
Yeah.
Doctor's excuses or a dime a dozen.
The reason why I'm saying that is Patch, one of our drivers, he doesn't miss. He's really good. I remember there was a time where he missed. And I don't miss either. But I'm not saying that there's not going to be a time that a medical condition, not just, I have the flu or, I have a doctor's note. There's going to be an extensive thing where some of our drivers have something that happens that's not looked upon. And if they're looking for that incentive to kind of help with the bills and stuff like that, that's going to hit them at a time that they weren't prepared for. We don't prepare to get sick and go into the hospital. I agree with the going to the meetings, the trying extra, because, that is something that we all need to do. But when it comes down to sickness and stuff like that, I think that's just kind of a difficult one to put into that.
I have a question for you.
Okay.
How do you determine one sickness from the other?
I understand that.
That's my only catch to making an exception. When you start making the exceptions for one,
and you've got one over here, you've got one back there, you've got one over there, you've got one over there. So.
Well, maybe more like a hospitalization then. Like when you're admitted into the hospital, that's not something that you're planned, you know. Or maybe just.
I think that's.
Family, that's what brought up too.
Yeah, because you know, like my dad, 260 days.
Passed away, and I was scheduled to drive tomorrow. I'm going to miss. I'm sorry. But is that my fault? My mom died?
Or now you have to make the decision, do I get the money?
Bereavement's a different story.
Well, I'm still.
Well, then maybe have it where.
I'm still.
No. Bereavement would not be part of that part. That's not what we're talking about. Bereavement, you can't help it if a family member dies.
Do I understand correctly that any absence other than bereavement would count against this or disqualify them for the institution?
Yeah, anything that we don't have 60 days. That we already have.
And there is a policy on bereavement.
Right.
Okay, but then more so maybe not like, you know, I'm sick for the flu, but like when you get put into the hospital, something that's not.
Hospitalization.
Yeah, something like that that doesn't
it'd
count against the driver.
It'd really be hard. It'd be tough. It'd be tough.
Or at least something to think about.
Do you have good insurance?
Do what?
Do you have good insurance? Well, if you've got good insurance, they'll put you in the hospital for anything.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I understand that, but you're also not getting your pay, or you're getting, not only are you losing out on your regular bus run that you'd be doing, but now you're also losing out on a bonus that goes over, or an incentive that goes over a certain amount of days, is what I was saying.
Okay.
Well, just something to think about.
You got sick days, so you're going to be paid for the sick days.
Yeah, you still have your
she
sick days.
Okay. Yeah, just the incentive part of it.
With the incentive, like she said, with taking days off, is there any way in there to put a certain, like 3 days, you can miss 3 days or something like that? Because what happens if you got jury duty?
Within your team, you have a lot of choice.
Yeah, there's a policy on jury duty.
All right, Steve's going to be just like, don't be a
girl. You don't want
to get it don't matter. That's why I don't know
the way. So, you got on the table. We've got on the table. Starting driver pay at $65 per day. An incentive bonus program at, I'm spitballing the number, $200 every 60 days. If you meet the criteria, go to your safety training, no accidents, and you don't miss other than bereavement and jury duty. You're entitled to a bonus of $200 every 60 days.
Yeah, but Chris, you give us so many sick days that.
Right, you still get 5 sick days.
That's
you get a sick day every month. What is it?
With the sick days, another problem is I got God knows how many sick days of people that I can't use them. I'm never sick. Now, my thing is, why can't we change sick days to PTO days at the end of the year? We can cash them out for even more.
If they could afford to pay them, there wouldn't be a problem. Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken, if you're looking to retire from the state of Hawkins County with 30 years of experience, you can be compensated for that, and it actually counts toward retirement. Mm-hmm. So if you have bus drivers, if I understand, is on a 185-day contract. So if you have 185 days, then that counts toward a year toward retirement. If you have 90 days, then there's, or 80 days, there's 4 months toward retirement of experience that you can convert into experience anyway. So having those days, now they don't, is there any compensation for bus drivers for that sick days, like being able to sell it back?
Only from 2014-15 school year forward, all new hires have to carry it. And if it was before that, they have an option of being paid out because they had been paid out before. So
if he works for us for 20 years and he's never sick, he said, so he's accumulated 200 sick days. When he retires, he should get a year's experience. But the 6 days that he hasn't used, does the district pay him any fund for those?
Now that I can't answer,
I don't know.
Like I said, I mean, that's not going to be enough to order. Next week I got so many sick days I consider driving my personal vehicle getting a rate. I got all these sick days because my family, but I couldn't do it. At the end of this year I could have cashed them in, bought me a boat, did this. I mean, they're just sitting there banking up and up and up and up. And then another thing is if you stay out 3 days you got to have a doctor's note. That's true. I mean, 2 days, 3rd day you got to have a doctor.
Yeah,
so you, like, if it was PTO, so you can't really take a vacation. Exactly. Like, they're just banking there. Now, there could be a way around it. Like, if every week I say I'm sick, I wouldn't get the incentive, but yet I'm cashing in my days a little bit by a little bit. I mean, like, that's what I'm talking about. Like, there's no perk to sick days if you can transfer them over to PTO and you can cash them in at the end of the year.
Yeah, I can't answer that question as far as being able to cash them in. I didn't say that. It was told to me this is the way it had to be. Okay, I don't make policies nor I just pass along what has to be passed along. I don't know when they decided. Well, like I say, it's 2014, 2015. I don't know what actions were taken to make that happen, but that's what was told to me in my position. From this point forward, everybody has to carry their sick days. I don't know where it came from. But I agree with you on the sick days. If you're a school bus driver, it's hard to take sick days.
Yeah, I mean, well, because like I said, many years, stuff like that, a lot of people, they do field trips. I used to sub inside the classroom, get extra money and stuff like that throughout the month. But in the summertime, you're locked into just that one little base pay. But if you have PTO time, you can cash in. That can help you get through the summer until school year starts back again.
Is that something that we could take this under advisement and come up with an answer at our July board meeting on that aspect of it?
Let me check.
Yeah. Yeah, because that's... Like I said, there's a lot of state rules, laws, and regulations that we don't know. Mr. Smith, would you have any insight on that?
On the sick days?
Yeah.
Typically, you know, bus drivers are part-time employees. They work for 180 days a year. He mentioned the vacation time. Well, you know, you don't really get vacation. You got all summer for your vacation time. We have... And it varies from contract to contract in terms of a number of, we call them paid time, paid days off. It may be 5 over the course of the year that we provide. And again, it varies contract to contract. I also was listening while you were talking about your incentive plans. In some places, we actually have incentive plans in place. It always comes up, what happens if I just miss one day? We've got some incentive plans in place where you got an amount, and if you don't miss any days, you get 100% of the bonus.
So
if you
miss
2 days, if you get 2 days,
yeah,
you might get 50%. 3 days, 25% more than 3 days. Not. So there are ways that you could,
okay,
do that as well.
Yeah, prorating that works. That's not a bad idea.
If you miss no days, you get $200. You miss one day, you get
that bill percentage.
But that's also tax, right? So it won't be $200.
That's going to be that.
The next question is, who's going to oversee and administer all this?
you're opening a can of worms, so to speak. And somebody's going to have to keep up with 90-some drivers and 90-some attendances, and it gets to be very conglomerate.
Karen ain't smart enough.
I mean, to me, it just seems, to me, it seems simpler to look at pay raise, and if not, you know, maybe part now, part later, or a beginning driver can't make that. They might start out at one pay, and after a year's experience, they go to that 75 or whatever that is agreed upon. But, you know, like she said, then you got all these critical, well, I was sick, I was this, I was this. And then you got mad drivers, you got upset drivers, you got people fussing, people complaining. I didn't understand it that way. It really, it's like a can of worms, so to speak, too. Just listening.
So, 65, increasing to $65 a day, starting pay. That's your starting pay. So, where's the scale?
Which one? The one we just approved?
So,
here's the one.
Here we go. So, how many years of experience you got?
Me, sir?
Yeah.
Oh, I just started. That's what I'm saying. I'm just listening and putting the input that I hear coming around the room. I'm a mail carrier.
I've got 10 years, Chris.
Okay, 10 years. You would go to 75-60.
What about 30 years?
It stops at 20 plus. Sorry. You would go to, we're at 79-60 plus 5.
Why shouldn't I be making the same as her and be doing the same job, Chris?
Because you don't have the same experience.
Well,
years of experience.
Well,
you said 10. You said 10.
Correct.
She said 30, and we're at 20 plus.
Can I inject something?
Yeah.
Just for your own information, I took it upon myself, since I'm on this committee, to contact some other systems from school board people that I have a relationship with professionally on the school board. And none of them that I talked to have any kind of longevity pay. Don't matter if you've been driving since you were in the third grade, you make the same money as a guy that started yesterday.
Oh.
Most of them are that way. That's the way let me give you one in particular. I won't tell you what it is, I'll tell you privately, but this particular system right here has what they call code 1 drivers, code 2 drivers, and code 3 drivers. The code 1 drivers make $58.82 a day, or $29.41 for a half a day. If they want 10 checks, they get $1,088 and a dime. 12 checks is $906.75. A code 2 driver is a driver that, this driver makes $78.82 a day, or $39.41 for a half a day, but this is a driver that's got two routes. He makes $20 more than their basic pay when he does two routes. The code 3 is special ed, and then they have special ed preschool, and they both make the same amount of money, and it's $62.25 a day. And it's broken down, and all of that's half on half days. So they both, that's the way they are. Now, I did try to contact, and a substitute driver makes $58.82. So they make, a substitute makes the same thing as a code 1 driver. And there's no longevity, because I contacted them back, there's no longevity. They do offer them the insurance, you know. Just basically the way we do. Well, they don't give them any money. They just can't. They can't get on the insurance for the first year. So, I'm just throwing that at you, because what my experience has been so far, it looks to me like that someone in our system at some point in time, because we've had this longevity thing, I'm sure, for quite some time, that we're trying our best as a board now. And we have for the last 3 years tried our best to bump this up a little bit every year to give you guys what you know, get you guys up there, and even with what have been proposed by the administration now, and what we're trying to do now, you guys, even a starting out drivers, you know, it's not a great deal difference from 60 to 58, 82, but those people stay there for 20 years. They don't go next year up $1.40 and the next year up another dollar. They don't go nowhere. They're right there.
Is that the reason the counties don't have no bus drivers?
Probably part of it. So don't get me wrong. I'm not trying to say that's anything that I would even consider, because I'm a firm believer the longer you work somewhere and the response. And I'm also a true believer, because I've managed a lot of people at one time myself, that people that have great responsibility need to be compensated for. I mean, it's just like whoever the CEO is, if they're responsible for every single person in the whole system and every, like our school system and the students and everything else, then they ought to make good money. They should. So whoever is responsible for what, and don't get me wrong, guys, I am not undercutting the responsibility that you have, because I drive a church bus and I know what that's like when you got those kids and you see these wrecks all the time and all these kids are getting, you know, killed and stuff. It makes you proud that we've got a system that's pretty safe.
Yes, it is.
That doesn't go unnoticed, I'm telling you, because I've got one of you bus drivers that I deal with all the time that keeps me well informed and not under a low key. So we want to do what is best, what we can do financially that is best for you guys, so that you realize we're not just sitting up here on this board like a bunch of heads on Route Rushmore. Rushmore, we're trying to get you where you want to be.
That's what I'm fixing to do. Here's a proposal. We're going to increase starting pay $65 to an additional $5 over 3 years, and the incentive program with bonuses of $100. This is all that system can do, and it's stretching it to do that. But you're important. There it is. So in 8 years, a starting driver would start out at $70 a day. Am I correct? In 3 years.
Yeah. Okay.
We build it to that. We get you to $70 plus the incentive. Minus jury duty and bereavement.
$100 a month, man.
Bonus. The incentive program, every 60 days, you would be entitled to $100.
That's too much.
Ladies and gentlemen, we need you. The school system needs you. And look what else we're taking to the full board to change the working conditions. We're hearing you talk. We're going to move forward. We're going to do more things.
Well, that's another thing.
But that would be my recommendation.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's based on the number of days that they're employed, right?
12 weeks.
The 60 days is based on the number of days that they're employed, right?
You couldn't start the day before the incentive was paid out and be expected to be paid. No, I wouldn't think so. No. You'd have to be 64 days.
Yeah.
Right.
From day of employment, you
have 60 school days.
School days. Yeah.
School days.
From time of
employment. That's the number of days you're employed.
60 school days. Right.
Yeah, that's what I'm getting at.
60 school days, not 60 calendar days. 60 school days.
Which is actually.
Okay. There it is.
My prostate is starting to go down.
Say that all over again.
We'll stay.
I'm gonna
come out
there. Chris, can you pass this information on to Karen?
Do what?
Can you pass this information on to Karen? About the $100.
Well, the board has to approve it.
I mean, if they do approve it, though.
We're at $60 now, starting pay. We're going to $65 if the board approves it. Then over the next 3 years, starting next year, to build it up to an additional $5. But starting, if the board approves it, this school year, an incentive program for every 60 days, if you meet the criteria, barring jury duty and bereavement, you're entitled to a $100 bonus.
What about spring break and stuff like that?
You go on spring break, you don't get a bonus. No, you don't get a bonus.
You're not.
But look at the other things that we're looking at. Ladies and gentlemen, this is... I'll feel the wrath here in just a little while. Sure.
So you got a $3.3 million deficit.
Yeah.
I got one more
But now let me justify my recommendation. Our teachers can't teach if the students aren't here.
You got a $3.3 million deficit.
Thank you.
Our teachers can't teach if the students aren't here. If the students aren't here, we can't meet attendance requirements. We can't get funding through the BEP formula. Am I correct? It is what it is. I don't like it. The system don't like it. The taxpayers don't like it, but it is what it is. Now, I don't know if it's going to be approved or not. I don't. But that's my recommendation, and if it is approved, I'm hoping you bus drivers will latch on to that and say, okay, we're going to do what we need to do. But I'm here saying we're going to get with the principals, and we're going to come up with some educational things, and we're going to involve the bus drivers more in this team that is Hawkins County Schools. Okay? Yes, ma'am.
You keep talking about the beginning drivers. I've been 43 years. Well, I've been making the same as the beginning drivers.
No.
That's $5 a day he's talking about there.
In other words, what they're when you bump that to 65 for the beginner, then that bumps it 5 additional for
everybody.
Everybody
on the skate.
Is that, am I correct? Correct in that?
Yeah. Yes. Everybody on the skate. We wouldn't do it no less.
We didn't understand.
Yeah, it bumps the whole pay scale up. Except for me. They don't get it.
So basically, they're getting an $8 increase based on the three that's already in.
Over a 4 year period. It'll go to 5 in 1 year, and in 3 years, the board will institute that additional $5.
It will, but
not all at one time. Our credit card ain't that big.
So each year we're just getting an extra dollar and some cent extra to get up to $5 after that.
After this year. But the incentive program is
already $5. The incentive program is already
okay, let's do this. Do it over 2 years. It's $250 a year. It's better than what you've been getting.
Well, I'm better than what you've been getting.
Well,
are you saying they start at 65 this fall?
Yeah, if the board approves it.
That's the confusion.
So this fall we start at 65.
Yes.
Our $5 plus.
Next year, why can't you just give us the rest and be done with it? Instead of saying next year.
Because we got to find it in the budget.
We got a deficit.
I'll tell you where the budget is.
Have a deficit in the
county. Quit putting rocks out of houses. Quit sitting there and buying those police cars. Quit doing a bunch of other stuff.
We're not the police department. I will amend my recommendation to $65. To $65 and the other $5 over 2 years, and it's $250 a year. Makes the math simpler. Plus the incentive program.
It's going to be cost prohibitive.
Mr. Lobster, what's your thoughts on that?
If I understand it, I'm going to say this first. I was left in charge to get this together to benefit the bus drivers. I took it upon myself because I'm afraid it's going to get forward or this or that, and I didn't care. So I took a scale that was turned down that I was told by nobody in this room, and I dropped it $5 each to $75.95. Okay? And so you all know what the petition said, and you know what you signed. I did all I can do. And I know the school board's got a budget. And I know that it's in taxpayers. And I feel like that they can get this budget. I got confidence in them that they will back the bus drivers better in the future. I feel that. And if I'm not mistaken, just rattling off numbers, I'm not no mathematic person, but I think that $3 brought it up to about 67, didn't it? $1,000 a year or something.
Yeah.
What you're asking for, right here, what we asked for, $75.95, half of that will bring it up to $131,000 or $2,000, just guessing at it. And the max would have been
$276.
So you know, and I know, that is a burden on the budget. I mean, common sense. I feel like that this committee right here would help us to achieve, just like a baby learning to crawl and walk. Okay? And I believe they'll put us there, or put you there, to help you in your situation. And anything is better than nothing.
Give us time to work on it. Let's work together. But, moving forward, we've got one more thing. But, committee, that's my recommendation. Any other proposals? Anybody?
Well, let's get it down and see what it looks like
on the flag.
What we've done so far. Let's
but is everybody in agreement with that recommendation? Okay. We got one more thing. And I'm learning nothing.
We got a tough sell. And I'll say this, we probably have a tough sell to address the board, but we'll try.
We'll
do our best.
Over 2 years. With the incentive program in place.
You mean five next year?
$250, $5 over 2 years. And then the incentive program at
$100 for 60.
Chris, when would the 60 days start? Begin the school year. August,
September? If the board approves it.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
First day of school. First time you're in your bus. My rubber.
Well, we'll have to come up with the explanation of how that's going to work and the criteria and everything, and you guys will be privileged to that information.
Okay.
We'll see that whoever our transportation director is gets it to.
Now, here's the other option. Sir, I've kept you waiting almost 2 hours.
Yeah.
I'm taking the liberty to invite a gentleman in that works for First Student. His name is Fred Smith. He is employed by a company that contracts out busing services to school systems. And before everybody goes, whoa, wait a minute, I'm out of a job. No. This man is here to give us advice, recommendations. Just tell what services his company has to offer. But I also want to say, I've spoke to this man. If this board were to do anything like this, the first people that would come, they would come to, is you guys as drivers. But to be prudent to our duties and responsibilities, we've got to look at all options. All options. And present that back to the full board. Okay?
Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Chris. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to come here and speak to you tonight. I'll be brief. You see, we've gone through. But what I want to do, I want to tell you just a couple of things. First off, I want to tell you a little bit about myself. Tell you a little bit about my company. Tell you, just talk to you just a little bit about some of the reasons that school districts actually consider contracting. And then talk about some of the questions that I know that you'll have when it comes to contracting. And then talk about a little bit about what you could expect should you contract. Okay. First of all, I'm in the school bus and transportation. I'm director of business development. I work with school districts across 9 southern states, and I have worked with others in various parts of the country. So for about the past 20 years, I've been in the transportation business. But before going into the transportation business, I was like Spady. I was a school administrator. I was associate superintendent and chief financial officer for Little Rock School District in Little Rock, Arkansas. We had over 300 buses there during my time there. And during my time there, we actually chose to contract out the transportation services at Little Rock. And it proved over time to be a very good decision for them, because there were a lot of reasons that they wanted to do it. Working with First Student and its predecessor, Laidlaw Transportation, again, for the past 20 years, I've been doing this. I've been working with school districts basically across the South and the Midwest. I've worked with dozens of school districts during that time, some of which actually contracted. Others decided to keep the operations in-house. Now, why do districts actually look at contracting? There are a number of reasons. There could be financial reasons. There could be change in administration reasons. There could be capital issues, not having money to buy buses. They could potentially just be looking to upgrade their level of services. They might want to move the management of a bus transportation function from basically school administrators to a company that does nothing but transportation. So I'm sure you got several of those reasons you might be looking at here in Hawkins County as to why you might be considering. I know that you're about to experience a change in your management of the transportation function. I know that you've got some routing issues that need to be addressed and need to be resolved. So those are some of the things that a private contractor can bring to you to make sure that the operations are as efficient as they can possibly be. So when it comes to, you know, your main concerns, I think your top concern here are the people sitting out in this audience. You're concerned about your drivers. And I'll just say this as a preface. I know that we got one minister. We got a Sunday school teacher back there somewhere. So they could probably help me with this loose quote from a proverb. It says, though something along the lines of, who can find a virtuous woman? For her price is greater than rubies. Is that close to being
that's
right?
Close.
That's close.
That's close enough.
That's close. Well, I want to tell you that in our organization, we consider bus drivers a virtuous woman. And we understand the importance of bus drivers. If you were to contract out, I know it'll be said that a private company is going to come in here and take jobs out of Hawkins County. That is absolutely not true. The first people that we're looking for are the drivers in their existing positions. There's no way that we would want to come in and try and cut what you've got in place in terms of driver compensation and benefits. We would work those things into a contract. So I've heard what Chris has offered. So if they were to actually contract for reasons other than that, to improve the operations, looking at potentially some technology improvements and so forth in the district, that piece would not be undermined. It would not be cut. Anything, it'd be increased. Because that's the way I've done contracts in the past. I know I can't make them work if we come in and try and put on the backs of the drivers the cost of the contract. It just doesn't work like that. So you're concerned about your employees. We're concerned about the employees. We want those employees to work for us. Now, there are many ways that we, different options. Some people have different separate situations in terms to health benefits or pension plans and so forth. We can work it, make sure that it works, that it's to the benefit of all concerned. I know that the district would be concerned about its fleet should it decide to contract. There are some options to consider when it relates to fleet. You know, the first option, the district could actually sell its existing bus fleet to the contractor. The contractor will write them a check for those buses and then go ahead and maintain the buses and do the operation. Well, I would never recommend that. When I was in this position in Little Rock, I did not recommend that. There's another option you could have. You know, you've already got buses in place. Turn those buses over to the contractor for the maintenance and operation. And as additional buses need to be acquired for replacements based on age, accidents, or whatever the case may be, the contractor could bring in those additional buses and through attrition go through the bus ownership process. That makes pretty much the most sense in my mind, that way that the board is taken out of the need to come up with capital dollars for future capital expenditures, you know, because we know a school bus is an expensive piece of equipment out there. I walked on one of the new buses out there today that's on your lot, and it's a nice bus. It's got eight camera systems and so forth on it, but that bus cost about roughly, cameras and all that stuff, roughly $85,000 piece. So you can get into looking to some have some substantial capital expenditures going forward. Oftentimes, you know, districts want to pass that off and make sure that it's covered in an overall contract. The other option when it comes to fleet ownership, you continue to own all your buses, turn them over to a contractor for operations and maintenance, and as new buses are required, bring those buses into the system. That way you keep full ownership of your fleet throughout the contract. Those are options that will be specifically up to the school board should they decide to contract. I know that you're concerned about your existing facilities. This is a nice facility here. A contractor would basically operate from within your existing facility going forward with it there. So, you know, you take care of your employees, give you the best option when it comes to fleet, and take care of your facilities. One thing that oftentimes comes up is districts may be concerned about the control of their transportation operation. Says, well, if I turn this over to a contractor, then I've lost all control over it. Well, that's far from what happens. In fact, you actually maintain better control over your existing operation because now you've got an outside entity that's here at your employer, at your direction, following your directions on how you want your transportation system run. So instead of actually turning over your system to an outside source and losing all control over it, you gain greater control. What you get by bringing in a contractor, you get a separate partner, a corporate partner that comes in and work with you and work to improve your overall transportation system. Be that by upgrading fleet, providing technologies. I'll just speak to one thing on technology. All of the buses in our fleet, all the buses that we have under our operation have GPS units on them. I mean, in today's environment, it's just kind of, you really need that level of control over your buses. You need to be able to know where your buses are at all times. We also have systems in place where we can actually keep track of the buses, let you know what students are on there, where the buses are along their routes. There are a lot of technology improvements that a contractor can bring to a district. And you can actually, working with a contractor, you can get yourself into that position, Chris, where you would be the envy of surrounding systems when it comes to transportation management. Now, I'll answer any questions that you might have, but this is an option. Several districts do it. Nationwide, there are roughly 450,000 school buses on the road. About a third of those are operated by private contracting companies such as my own. And our company, First Student, is the largest provider of contracted transportation services in North America. We operate roughly about 45,000 buses across the country. Go ahead.
So if we contract out, let me get this straight. Mm-hmm. You come in and you do all the services. Mm-hmm. We don't have payroll for the bus drivers. We don't have the maintenance of the buses. We don't have the liability insurance of the buses. We still have the facility and the maintenance cost of the facility.
Right. Or you could, if you wanted to, include the day-to-day updates, your lawns, your janitorial costs, and so forth. You can include that in the cost of in the contract price for the contractor to take care of the existing facility. We take it over as it is now, and we keep it up to date with any needed capital improvements that will still be on here.
So I want to go back to payroll for our system. Right now, that's all done at central office for all of our transportation employees. Is that correct, Mr. Bell?
Actually, I do all the payroll here in Senate. The central office.
And then they cut the checks?
They cut the checks.
Where it's direct deposit.
Yeah, direct deposit. Yeah.
So you the administrative burden around 120 school bus drivers, six maintenance staff, your office staff in there, all of that administrative burden would pass to the contractor. You would pay for all of that through your monthly cost of the contract.
Right, one check.
One check.
How long would it take you to do that? Right, one check is figuring about it. It don't matter. You ain't
gonna he got 3 days just to figure the payroll.
Yes, sir.
You know what I'm asking? How much is your fee per year contract?
That's not determined.
That number has not been determined. The cost of a transportation contract is not like the cost of a big pen. You can walk into any Walgreens across the country and pay 99 cents for a big ink pen. Contracts for transportation services depends a lot on what's required, what's in the specifications, what the district wants. Your current cost to your cost of driver cost here is one thing, driver cost somewhere else is another thing. That amount has to be determined, and that amount is determined. First off, the district would have to do one of two things. They'd have to issue an RFP. They'd have to specify just exactly what they want. They specify conditions in terms of bus age, maintenance cycles, and so forth. Any required technology that they would want, and based upon that list of qualifications, the cost is determined. I can't give you a cost right now up front. There's a lot of things that has to take place before you actually get the cost. And of course, you're not obligated to do that. You can do that, you specify it, and see what it costs, and you compare that to what it would cost you if you were to do the same things that you're asking the contractors to do.
We were talking earlier, and it would, yes.
How much do you, if they do decide to contract out, and basically what you're saying is you pick us up for employees, right?
Yeah.
Like we basically work for you. Now, we won't fall under Hawkins County policy and procedure that they set up with the Board of Education. So what do you pay starting out driving?
Okay, when you say you work for us, they have ultimate control. They dictate to what us pay. And the very first thing that I said when I started talking was, there's no way that we're going to pay a driver less than what they're currently making. Off cases, it's actually more, depending upon the local labor market, if it takes more to actually recruit and retain drivers there. So there's not a specific amount that I can tell you, we pay a bus driver X number of dollars, because it varies from contract to contract, from state to state. But here, no one would be, you would not expect to make anything less than what the school board is offering.
Question. Say you take it over. Mm-hmm. You got people here ready to retire. People can retire. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You got employees in here that can retire. Mm-hmm. Before their retirement, they lose all that out the window.
No. If you're in a position where you can retire, and in fact you mentioned something that can be a great benefit to Robert. If you are in a position where you can retire from the system, you've got to take that retirement check, come to work for us, and still drive the bus, and you get two sources of income. Now you can't get your retirement until you actually stop working.
If we're not working for Humboldt County no more, and we're their liability, mm-hmm. and we're working for you, I missed something somewhere.
No, you can do that. Because they're a separate entity.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
You're not working for Hawkins County, you're working for a...
But what happened to the Hawkins County retirement that they've done work?
They draw it out.
They draw it.
It's there. It's for you. If you invested in that retirement plan, that's yours.
Can't take it out.
Okay, I like... if I understand the policy right, I like the next January, and I have my 5 years in according to my age, and I can retire for $1.25 to $25 a month.
If that's what it is.
If I start working for you before my 6 months is up, I still can work my January and get my retirement from Hawkins County.
That's a decision that the district can make if someone is within a certain. So you're not vested in the retirement plan yet, is what I'm hearing you say. Okay. We could actually work out an arrangement with the county, whereas those folks that are within 1, 2, 3, you plug in, you fill in the blank number of years of vesting in the retirement system, could remain on the payroll of the county and still be managed by us.
Yeah, the options are unlimited. We can negotiate anything that we need to negotiate.
Right.
All of these systems here, you can't take your bus home with you. Oh,
yeah. Who said that? Who said that would be the case in Hawkins County?
Wait a minute.
We do what makes sense. We have a lot of contracts where the bus drivers take their buses home, where they park them out. Because, you know, you're a rural county here. You spread from way down there to way up yonder.
And all
corn scattered in between. So.